to our Democratic Town Committee meeting, to our forum for meetings. And I am Suzy Rowe, I'm chair of the Democratic Town Committee here in Brookline. And we have a couple of things, some committee business to get through before we get to our speakers tonight. So, just so you know, the first thing on our list is we have 14 people who want to be associate members of the Democratic Town Committee. And we have a nominating committee report. Pat, do you want to give the report, or do you want me to read it?
You have all the paperwork, so it's better you.
That is true, I have all the paperwork. So, here are the folks who the nominating committee has recommended as associate members of the Democratic Town Committee. Pablo Alvarez, Michael Cohn, Wendell Taylor, Pamela Katz, Nicole Haver, Julie Bruno, Charles Terrell, Meg Burmistrand, Judy Friesen, Phyllis Graham, Urban Larson, Alex Sheff, Evelyn Weil, Sally So, and Kyle Klaus. So we have 14 folks, and unfortunately, I think we've been thanking the results of the presidential election.
Charles Terrell.
Charles Terrell, sorry. There he is, Charles Terrell.
Tell him, please.
Yes, yes, indeed. So we had a unanimous vote of the nominating committee to accept these folks, and then a unanimous vote of the executive committee to accept the nominating committee report. So I report that out to you. And with that, for folks who are here on this list, I have now become associate members of our Democratic Town Committee. So congratulations to you. And if you're one of those people in the room right now, raise your hand. So there's Charles, there's Alex. Now, if you were not on that list, and you are not an associate member of the Democratic Town Committee, do not worry. You can get an application, and you can be in the next round of people we put on. So come see me at the end, and I'm happy to send out applications, because the more, the merrier. Next, we also have to renew our associate members every year. So, just so folks know, the nominating committee took a look at that as well, and there were some people who have unfortunately passed away or have moved out of Brookline. So just so you know who those folks are, Marsha Heist passed away this year, and Ed Richmond. And folks who have moved out of Brookline are Connie Katz, Jules Levine, and Jane Spring. So just so folks know, but all our other associate members were renominated, renewed. So congratulations, you were an associate member, have no fears, you are still an associate member. And the next thing I wanted to say is that we have every year, every 4 years on the presidential primary ballot, we have 35 people who run to be elected Democratic Town Committee members. We also have 20-year members, so if you've been an elected member for 20 years, you no longer have to run on the ballot, but you're considered an election member for life. However, in those 35 people who ran on the ballot, two of them have now moved away. So, one moved to Texas, one moved to DC, which means we have two openings for elected members. So, associate members get the privilege of being able to apply for elected member seats when we have vacancies. So, associate members, you will be getting a mailing to ask if you want to apply to be an elected member, so watch out for that. The applications will be due sometime in mid-June. So watch your mailboxes. There were two other things I wanted to mention to you. We usually have an event in July for the Democratic Town Committee, a weeknight in July, which has proved to be very successful. So we'll be back in touch with you about that. But if folks have ideas about speakers that you'd like to hear, something interesting you'd like to see or do in that July event, just let me know. We're taking ideas for that now. And the last thing I wanted to mention was there's a group that has come together in town that the Democratic Town Committee helped to put together called Force Multiplier. Some of you may have heard about this. There's been lots of groups who've started to meet. Indivisible groups, our revolution groups, Democratic Town Committees, groups that are meeting in people's living rooms. So we got together a room full of all the organizers of all those groups across Brookline, Newton, and Wellesley, and there were more than 25 of those groups. They enjoyed meeting each other so much that they are now part of a group, they're communicating with each other, they're cooperating with each other on out of state races and the impeachment resolution, which those of you in town meeting probably are well aware of. There's a resolution on the town meeting warrant to encourage our congressional delegation to start impeachment proceedings against the president. So there's lots of things that group is doing. It's called Force Multiplier, and you'll hear more about that as they generate more and more activities. So with that, we are ready to start the forum part of our evening. Oh, and I should say we have some elected officials with us tonight. So I am looking at our governor's counselor, Marilyn Vitigo Devaney, over here. Our representative, Frank Smyser, our state representative. We have John Lessinger, our Democratic state committee man, over there. Ben Franco, selectman, once again. Tommy Vitolo, still our constable. Forgive me if I'm missing anybody. Tell me if I'm missing anyone. Pat Ward, our town clerk, is there. Our Moscato, school committee. Who else am I missing? All right, good. So with that, let us bring up our two speakers for the night, and then I get to introduce them, and then they get to do the hard work. And please get some refreshments, because this is part of why you come here, the Democratic Town Committee refreshments.
Thank you for having me. Who here has heard of Common Cause before? rights has always been a very central part of our mission, but a little less so before campaign finance. John Dawson Turner was there at the very beginning.
1987.
Yes, absolutely. Campaign finance has been a signature issue, but voting rights is so critical, especially these days, when a Republican Party has decided that one of the ways it can succeed electorally is by suppressing the vote with legal restrictions on voting. So the political landscape has changed. We saw a huge innovation over time. Massachusetts actually has been behind many straight states. We were behind North Carolina. North Carolina had early voting before we did. They had pre-registration of 16-year-olds before we did. They had a version of same-day voter registration. They do not have those things anymore. They do have an early voting period, but it's restricted because those were rolled back. In 2010, we saw a huge wave of restrictive voting laws passed across the country. More than 20 states passed restrictive voting laws since then. Things like voter ID, which is a solution without a problem to solve, causing all sorts of other things away. Because, you know, for those of us that live in one place and drive, it may not be a huge burden, but for many urban, poor, elderly, even military students, it would be a huge burden to have a photo ID. And 25% of poor urban African American people have no photo ID. Some of them are also to make restrictions on how to register, including the documentation that you require, cutting back early voting laws, all sorts of things. Luckily, we've had some success in the courts. So courts have rolled back some of the worst laws, finding them to be violations of either the Federal Voting Rights Act or even constitutional provisions. Unfortunately, the protection that we had under the Federal Voting Rights Act was rolled back in 2013 by the Supreme Court in Shelby County versus Holder, where they struck down the pre-clearance version part of the statute. And that required that states get Justice Department approval before they pass voting laws in the states that had a history of suppressing the vote with their voting laws. That is out of the water. We've been pushing really hard in Congress to get a replacement formula for that. That has not been successful. Well, the good news is that this sort of wave of voter restrictive laws has also been met with somewhat of a wave on the other side. So a number of states have actually passed laws to expand voting rights. And Massachusetts actually did that in 2014. I wrote some of the first drafts of that legislation 10 years prior. We did, for the first time, have early voting in 2016. Who voted early? All right, lots of people. Do you think it's a good idea? Yeah. So we were one of the last states to that party. There still are a few more, but I believe we're the 34th state. We also passed pre-registration of 16-year-olds, which is a little bit more cutting edge. There were about 11 states. Some of them were in now did not affect any voting totals that we know of, but there is a vulnerability. There is human error that audits can actually find and detect. It's a basic business practice. There's no reason we shouldn't be doing it for all of our elections. Just a spot check of 3% is what Massachusetts passed. We're one of 26 states that does that. The current landscape right now is that across the country, there are more expansive laws that have been introduced across the states. So there's a ray of hope there, especially automatic voter registration that we're going to be talking about. So he's going to go into a little bit more detail. That is CommonCause's top priority for this legislative session. I brought some materials here for you that you can pick up in the front afterwards if you like. A little fact sheet about it, and a little cheat sheet. You can actually write yourself your own letter to the Speaker and the Senate President, or you can pick up one of these things and use it, as well as just our general legislative priorities over the year. So, as I said, the wave may have slowed down, but it is still out there. 87 different bills were introduced across the country this legislative session to restrict voting rights, and 3 states have enacted them. No state has enacted expansive rules yet. We still have high hopes for automatic voter registration in Illinois. It was passed by their state legislature last session, but the governor vetoed that legislation. It just passed Senate, I believe it was again, and has been bipartisan, so we expect that it probably will go through. We think the governor will sign in Illinois. But it is up to us, I think, as the cradle of liberty, to start holding that beacon of what it should be like to have good voting laws. We can't, because of the way we elect the president, counter what happens in other states necessarily, but we can set an example. And we have a really critical campaign that will involve more people in the political process, will streamline bureaucracy, and actually increase the accuracy of voter rolls, and there's absolutely no reason that we shouldn't do it. So with that, Cindy, we'll talk a little more about the meetings, and I'll be happy to answer any questions on these.
So before I even start, just a small loved it when I started in New Hampshire. It was actually great because people would come in with their children that were just voting. They would announce they were there. Everyone there stood and applauded. They made a big deal about how important it was to be able to vote, and I thought that was great. So I'm a big fan of that as well. But I was amazed to learn that 680,000 people in Massachusetts could vote and don't vote. So here we go to the same discussion of income inequality, racial disparity. Where are the people that aren't voting? It's the same people, the people who may not know, are working hard. They really wanted to do it. They didn't realize they could. And what happens is an election, and they didn't do it. And what is important, we are so fortunate to live in a country where everybody can vote. And what's so important is we need to make it easier for people to vote. So this automatic voting, so presently, if you go to the registry to renew your license, you can ask, but you may not know that you have the right to register to vote. This bill is an opt-out bill. In other words, when you go to renew your license, when you go to the registry, you would have an automatic voting. You would, given there might be certain reasons that you would not be allowed to vote, but it would be up to you to opt out of the system. The Secretary of State is involved here and would need to develop a program so that all of the areas where you could have automatic voting registration, they're called registration centers. Right now under the bill, it's assumed that the registry of motor vehicles would be one. I don't know if there'll be another one. She would come in and you could, or you could do it by mail, and you would renew your license, and you would then be able to, and then you would automatically be entitled to register to vote. Now, the program that we have proposed is that there are 21 states that have automatic voting rights, and those states have entered into an agreement with a registration information center. The state pays a fund. There's a registration information center. So the registry would send a notice to the registration information center, who would be responsible for keeping track of, is this person really living in this particular town? Is this person alive? All of the kinds of things that we would be concerned with. And they would send a notice to the town clerks or whoever, the election commissioner. Now, I know that the county board does a great job, and I would not be worried. This would be not something that I wouldn't worry about what would happen in the line. And I told them as I passed them, we're going to make it simple. But it does mean that there would be more people voting, and the notice of whether this person would be voting or not would go to in the town of Brookline, it would go to the county board. I'm very supportive of everything we can do to try and get more people in the system, more people voting, more people who could be, if you have ideas, this is something we should do. And I am keenly aware of other states where they try to stifle voting, where they've said that people have voted. We have this false news about people voting in Massachusetts, voters voting in New Hampshire. Of course that didn't happen, and there's never been any proof of it. But we need to make sure that people can vote and make it easy for them, because again, it is not a privilege, it's a right in this country to be able to vote. So the automatic voting is just one of the bills that I have been involved in. Again, many of them looking at the issues of income inequality and race disparity and saying, what can we do? In addition to this, I'm very much involved in a criminal justice package. There's a way that we can do something important in this state. Since 1970, prisons have seen, we have more people incarcerated. We've been tougher on crime, and it hasn't worked. And the interesting thing is that in the Republican states, they looked at being smart on crime as a way to save money, but we haven't really done that in Massachusetts. We have this thing called minimum mandatory sentences. You have for not being able to afford their funds. I do it as a lawyer, I've done family law. I understand how a family suffers when the breadwinner is not bringing the food home, bringing the money for food. Why? They couldn't pay the fine. $25 to some people is a lot of money. It's big, the fines add up. We added more fines since 1970. We now charge people that they have had in prison. We want to charge them everything. And they can't get out of the system, they can't afford it, and there are people serving in prison time only for the fact that they had a license that expired. And there was a fine, a small fine, that they couldn't pay. We need to take a look at this, and we need to make some serious changes to our criminal justice system. One more issue which I am also being sponsored on, and that is looking at the solitary confinement. There are people serving solitary confinement. I'll tell you one story about one woman who was found with a paperclip. I'm supposed to have a paperclip in jail. I'm not talking about Aaron Fernandez. I'm not talking about people who may be alleged to be violent. I'm talking about people who haven't had occasion to be violent, because in the state of Massachusetts, we have no criteria, no written criteria for who serves on solitary confinement. So if you have someone like this particular woman who was caught with a paperclip, they tried to punish her, and they punished her by putting her in solitary confinement. Admittedly, most of the people in prison have mental health issues anyway. There's no check on their mental health issues. And that woman sat in solitary confinement. It was horrendous. And my bill would require the state to say, if you put someone in solitary confinement, you have to prove that they're a threat to themselves, a threat to other prisoners, they've been guilty of some violence, and you have to have statistics and data. In my mind, I would be eradicate solitary confinement, but that isn't someplace we can go in our criminal justice system. So we need to really look at what we're doing, and we need to, one way to deal with the income inequality is to look at who's in prison, who doesn't get the things they ought to get, who doesn't vote. Now, if we don't have the Affordable Care Act, who are the people that are going to not have health insurance? They're the people that can least afford to not have it. They're elderly, they're children. Pre-existing conditions, a woman. Everything that you could do for pre-existing condition would fit into the category if you're a woman. So there's a lot of work to be done in Massachusetts, and we need all your help. Frank's working hard as well, and we need you to come out and support us. I know you always do. But I will say, even though the small group, the most important thing you can do is call your friends that don't live in Brookline. Because in Brookline, most likely, most people support automatic voting, criminal justice reform, and many of the things I talked about. But go out to the western part of the city. Call people in the Speaker of the House district. Talk to them and tell them where you are. Contact them if you have friends in those districts. That's the most important thing you can do. And hopefully we'll make some changes. Thank you.
So I'm going to ask you to say your questions into this microphone so that they can pick them up.
So that costs the state a lot of money, and it's very duplicative, and if you're at MassHealth and you just filled out like a 28-page form, the last thing you want to do is fill out another 2-page voter registration form when they already have all that information. So automatic voter registration is really about moving registration into the digital age, not making people keep doing the same thing over and over again to update their information, to fill out yet another form. And then, as Cindy said, it also points us to a consortium of states that shares voter information. Not cross-check, which is bad, because we're actually a number up, by the way, but the Electronic Registration Information Center, which is started by the Pew Charitable Trust. So it has both sides. It has, like, let's register more voters, but also make sure that our voting lists are as clean and accurate as they possibly can be without doing things like cross-check ups, which is kicking off anybody whose name is, you know, vaguely similar to someone.
Okay, some more questions on this item.
Hi, thank you. How would, what mechanisms are there for automatic registration of high school and college students who aren't getting driver's licenses? And presumably aren't, you know, probably aren't on that self. Are there any?
So that wouldn't be part of the automatic process. They would just have to do a registration drive here. At still at 16, and rather pre-register people to vote. The automatic registration process should interact with the pre-registration process as well, so if you are getting your driver's license, there would be that interaction. But it doesn't mean that the regular registration process changes. There still be people that go to town hall, there still be people that we do voter registration drives in the high schools. One of the advantages and one of the attractions to some of the Republican members in other states is that it does decrease the need for third-party voter registration drives. And some of the third-party voter registration drives are with paid, you know, canvassers who are paid by the registration form, their spot check by the organizations, but it may not be the best data in the world. So, you know, we are getting the best data that we can through our own state agencies like the RMV, like MassHealth. Like, let's use that and not rely on third-party agencies to really get out and push voter registration. It should be a state function. It shouldn't have to be nonprofits.
So when I pass the mic, one of the projects that I am most proud of for our Democratic Town Committee is we do send a birthday card to everybody who turns 18 in the town, wishing them happy birthday and enclosing a voter registration form in the birthday card. So.
Yeah, and that you could still do that.
Some of us are concerned about the low voter turnout in Brooklyn, and Senator mentioned that we should get more people voting and make it easier. And I was wondering any thoughts you had about the idea of changing our local elections from May to another time of year, say November, and
It's you're talking about scheduling a town election on a different date.
Yeah.
It's statutory. There's a window. I think it goes from the middle of February to the middle of May. If you want to do it out at any other time, other than that, would have to be a special act filed by the community, which the legislature passed to allow them to conduct the town election at another time, other than that window of opportunity to find the general laws.
So it's a very excellent question. And in fact, data by many academics show one of the reasons we have lower turnout in America is we have too many elections scattered all over the place. We have special elections, we have town elections, we have city elections, we have primary elections, our presidential primary is a different time. You know, it's very diffuse. And people, you know, forget. They don't hear the same way they do about the presidential. So the data is very clear. If you could consolidate these elections, you would have more participation. There are pluses and minuses. It would have to be a statutory change. There was a group of people that were actually investigating doing a ballot initiative on that. I thought it was a little in the weeds. I couldn't imagine people getting too excited about it all. But it probably would increase turnout, but then you have people competing for time, you know? So you have your town people running, you have your state people running, and you have your federal people running, and they're all trying to get attention, and that's one of the rationales, I think, about why this turned out, is the idea that, well, people could pay attention to it. The problem is that they don't.
And the reason I asked after is I didn't know what additional costs and people you would need, whether it was feasible from a number of people that they can have that are working on election day to be able to do all of this in one time. I think there's a cost.
Now, there's definitely a cost, and it's definitely a concern that we have. I mean, just a few times that we've conducted a special state election or a special state primary with our town election, mm-hmm. It's a lot of extra effort and a lot of work to do it all at once in some sort of uniform election for both federal, state, and local. You'd have to have a better mind than I to kind of parse that out and see if it would work or not.
Let me just comment on that, okay? It's a professor from Yale, political science guy, came up to me in precinct 7 and mentioned November election. But here's the problem, which was alluded to, touched upon. Cities are very different from towns. They have municipal elections in November. We have not only town elections, we have them every year. So that doesn't guarantee anything of a November election, because you might have it in a non-election year, matching, for example, Boston Municipal, but it wouldn't guarantee any more people would come out. If you had it in a presidential election, this fellow was arguing, yeah, a lot more people come out. But I wouldn't want to be running for selecting this town when the president was on the ballot or governor, because nobody would pay attention. It would also be much harder to raise money, because people would say, I gave it the office for the other offices. You know, for example, we have Governor Cox running here. You want to raise money when your own guy is running for governor and you're running for selectman. So these things are not easy. Mostly the races themselves generate. If you have a big race at the top, more people come out. But you're never going to have some simple solution to it. I just want to mention some other thing to these folks. As we know, we had an unofficial platform hearing here for the Democratic Party platform. The hearings, official hearings, ended on Saturday. Maryland's been to a lot of them. By the way, Ted Gross is here, he's my colleague in the State Committee, just walked in. But the platform drafting begins tomorrow, so if you folks want to give me any language, in my field that I was always best known for was voting rights. I was chairman of the committee for 6 years. I did the motor voter, the mail and voter registration, invented the affidavit. I'd love to listen to that language, and I'll look over that. I'm going to be doing a lot of the transportation thing, but I'll be happy to look at the voting rights thing if I put in what you guys want. But these things are not very simple to do. As you know, I don't know if you want to touch upon it, Dan, but one of our main enemies is ALEC, American Legislative Change Council. These right-wingers, funded by the Koch brothers, they don't have much strength here, but they've been coupled with the fast internet and quick access. They are amazingly what they do. They produce this model legislation, and that's how the voter IDs spread around. All the right-wingers in each state get a copy of the laws in their state, so that's a big enemy. And I want to ask one thing. I didn't think we were in ALEC. I talked about the galleries. In cross-check. You mean cross-check? I don't think Bill used it.
We don't use it. It's just we get the
We
our garbage from CrossCheck?
In terms of CrossCheck?
Yeah.
You can't really use it because federal law requires you basically to notify everybody. If you could just delete somebody because you know they're a duplicate while they moved out of town, that would be great. But we get a stack every year that big, and we can't. It really is just useless to us.
Yeah,
we
so
can't
I hear a big pile of paper.
Right. We can't do a thing with it. Questions, one out of curiosity and one because an administrative concern. But every voter registration agency that I'm aware of, except for the Registry of Motor Vehicles, is a hard copy agency. And you want to make electronic records. And I'm curious, has Seven Ways and Means done scoring this to see how much that would cost?
No. And some of them may not be ready.
I'm looking at a summary of the legislation, and I'm looking at Section 4, which concerns me greatly, because it basically is requiring the registrars to verify what was submitted to them. So my question is this, is that are you changing the affidavit in any way where we're not collecting all the information, both on citizenship and party information?
No.
And why does Section 4 require, it says, appears to those registration process decline to send them a if they haven't already declined, if they've opted in and they haven't declined, we're still supposed to send them a notice that
so
they didn't decline?
That's the opt-out section. So that is what Oregon does for an agency that collects all the information, gives it to you, let's say MassHealth. So they send you their copy of their then there is a card, which could theoretically be generated automatically, or it should be generated automatically, that says you'll be registered within, I think it's 20 days of the bill, unless you decline. And that's the opt-out bill.
So we have to go from opt-in and an opt-out?
Yes.
Okay, I know there are more questions. Where are your hands? All right, coming around.
I guess two unrelated points. First, I know that the data is pretty clear that if you have your elections in November, you can increase turnout, but what about a sort of more limited version where the state law gives us this 4-month range to hold town elections? Do you think it would be effective for towns to get together and decide that there is a first week of May town voting day in Massachusetts in the case even a state holiday. Would that be effective? And the other is, I'd like to hear more information about the cross-check and the electronic information center. I am concerned about the way the cross-check seem to misunderstand statistics in just terms of how many false positives we likely get on a regular basis. Is there anything we can do about that? Is there anything we can do in Massachusetts to prevent other states from disenrolling people just because John Smith happens to live here in Massachusetts?
So I can take the second one. I'm not sure I can comment on the first. That's really not politics. Maybe Sid, you'll want to take that one. As a state, you cannot really influence the election laws of another state. surprising number are already registered because they registered their classroom. But the question I have about this automatic voting, if you have to opt out, if you're not a citizen, you can't vote. You can get driver's license.
Right.
So are we making then a list of people who may be here legally or not, who have licenses or
so that's why we can't do it fully opt out at the registry, because we don't collect that information currently. And I don't see us changing that immediately. We do collect that information already at FAFSA. You can't, we already collect that. There are seven different questions on the mass health form about your citizenship status.
Is there on the driver's license?
No.
And then there's voter registration form. You have to sign it.
Yes, so your signature could attest that you have to have, if you want to register to vote. So it's going to be kind of more of a, it's an opt-in because you have to provide some additional information as a registered voter. It'll be worded a little bit differently. It will be a little bit more streamlined. And it will not be the full Oregon opt-out on the back end. That will only work for and the reason why you want to do it that way, if you can, like in Oregon, for example, is they had 250,000 people, they're a smaller state than we are, 250,000 people registered in the first 6 months of the law, and over 100,000 people voted for the very first time because they were registered on that. That's a huge number of people in the state that's even smaller than ours. It's growing. It's going to pass us soon, but that's a lot of people. That's comparable to the city of Worcester in terms of population voting for the first time. That's pretty impressive.
So at this point, and I'll save my comments.
Before I ask the question, I mentioned that the platform committees went throughout the state, and John Gossinger attended 13, so I think that is around 16. 15. But I just wanted to say that, there was talk about combining elections, and John mentioned the municipal elections and everything. I just wanted to, and I don't know whether this is a question for Pat, but I just wanted to bring up the presidential election year. You had an election in March for the president, okay? So then, in September, we had a state primary. And just personally, all representatives, congressmen were all unopposed except me. 8% came out in September. And I'm thinking, wouldn't it be better if they could combine that, except just the president, and put it together and save money and get more voter participation? Because I think people are thinking, well, I voted in March, that's the primary. Now I don't vote until November. And they just don't think September is another primary. And I don't know if that's a question for you, Pat. Can that be changed?
Anything can change. It's legislation. It's a general law. But, there has been some talk among my colleagues about recommending that the state primary be held in the spring, but that would require a number of changes for nomination reasons. You can't have a state of Russia and a primary together because you need to nominate them for in order to be on the state Russian ballot. But every other format, you can probably mix and match, but it would require an awful lot of change in the general laws. I'm not quite sure you can get there anytime soon.
Well, I'm not saying it for me personally, but I know watching the presidential year, that September primary gets about 8 or 9%. You know that.
Oh, yeah. Well,
they don't come out. It seems like what a waste of money to have two.
I mean, I appreciate the speaker's belief that more registration means more participation. I'm not quite sure of that. I mean, I've been around long enough to see that, what drives people out are the candidates. The issues is not necessarily being registered. And I hope that doesn't.
this is the second question I had. It's sort of broader, so we feel free to kind of come back to this at the end, but whether it's the voting rights piece or the form legislation you talked about, other than just trying to call it relevant to the locally Western Mass, unfortunately, my job, other things that we can do to kind of really help a lot of kind of those things that are coming in here?
Well, another thing is with the hearing, that would be a great time. So if you go on my website, or anybody's website, Catherine Anderson, who's the director, all those bills, the hearings are just starting on some of them, but it would be great to have participation at a hearing. And actually, that's a good point, because it's in addition to bringing people in from the Western state, it makes a difference if a lot of people here when there's a hearing and show interest. So that should be another one.
And we're having a lobby day on automatic voter registration on June 28th from 10 to 12. So if you want to participate in that, sign up on the form that's going around, and I'll send you an email about it at the State House, June 28th, 10 to 12. The hearing, I think, will be in early June. We could also, if you sign up on our list, we'll get a notification of that in your email inbox. Keeping in touch, letting your officials know how passionate you are about these issues, even if they're supportive, is always a good thing. During the month, telling them they're doing a great job. Yeah. Speaker, Senate President. Senate President tends to be very supportive of these issues. The Speaker is not an opponent. He just is not, that isn't his first thought. But is actually, been on board for a lot of these things. It really helps get the voting law passed in 2014. It just takes a little longer over there. So, keep in touch with your House members.
Okay, and with that, I wanted to make sure that we thank our speakers for coming out and talking about. Thank you.